Good morning, everybody. It looks like many people decided to have lunch instead to listen to my presentation, but I hope you will enjoy it nonetheless, and we'll try to be quick so that you can join everybody else for lunch. Now, the title of my presentation is The Digital Inflection Point, and as you can see, the word digital is between brackets, and there is a specific reason for that. I don't like the word digital. I think that it has passed its time, and I think that is divisive. I think it separates instead of uniting. As a consumer, as an individual, for me, digital means accessing information, news, entertainment, being connected with my friends, have an opportunity to share. As a marketeer, as an agency, I think digital for me means the electricity that empowers every marketing program. As such, as the electricity that empowers everything else, we don't talk about electricity. We don't say we're going to have a cold beer thanks to the fridge that works with electricity. It's obvious. It's taken for granted. It's part of our life. It's part of everything. It doesn't need to be specified anymore. It doesn't need to divide. It doesn't need to separate in a world which is becoming more and more integrated. I've taken this title, the digital, or the inflection point, from a book written by Andy Grove, the co-founder of Intel. He wrote this book called Only the Paranoid Survives. And he talks about the strategic inflection point of a business, which is the time in which you have to fundamentally change in order to grow, or you risk becoming obsolete. So it's like the cliff, where you get to the point and you've got to change, otherwise you fall. I've taken that title because I think that in the digital, I've got to reuse this word many times today, I think we are exactly at the same stage. We're forced to change, but not always we have realized and fully understood how to change, and many people are still slightly scared. I'm going to talk about two things today. The first one, I would like to have a look at where the global digital landscape is going over the next 2-3 years, just to share some view over what's going to happen next and how will it shape. And the second, probably more important, is how will it continue to shape and change the fundamental principles of consumer engagement. But let me show you a very short video to demonstrate why I think that digital really has become the electricity that powers marketing programs. Okay. Now, before I start, let me ask a couple of questions to you so we get to know each other better and I understand better who I have in front. Just a couple of questions. How many of you are a member of at least, say, two social networks? Can you put your hands up? It looks like 90-95% of the people in the room. Second question, how many of you have spent at least $100 on an online transaction, say in the last 30, 60 days, $100 or more? Again, 90-95%, fantastic. It's I have to say that, and I knew what to expect today, but I have to say that unfortunately at other conferences, other gatherings which are part of our industry, sometimes with this kind of questions, even now in 2010, you get answers like 40-50%, which sometimes is very worrying. And you understand that you're speaking to people that lead an entirely different life and they're not really participating in the same world that that we are. Anyway. The presentation today, I would like to talk about three things. The first one is a look at today's realities, what really matters, and what are the phenomena today that will really shape the trends of tomorrow. The second one are the key global digital trends that we expect to take center stage over the next 2-3 years. What are the implications of these trends, and how are they going to change marketing communication going forward? And the third one is just a view, a suggestion of what we think that leading marketeers need to do in the future as an entire organization, not just from the top, in order to be a part of this new life and to get ahead of this curve. So let's start by grounding ourselves in the key phenomenon in the digital space today that that really matter. And we have identified four areas which we think are important to us. And let's expand on each of one of them. You probably know all of them. The first one is the economy. In essence, how this is going to, the economical downturn, how is it going to impact on digital behavior? What has happened in the last 2 years? Has it really changed the life of consumers? Access, how the changing phase of access is accelerating and transforming digital engagement. Mobility, what is happening in a world which is becoming more and more unrestricted and social. It's not just about Facebook and Twitter, but how this new identity system, which is the behavioral overlay of the web, is really influencing everything we do from search to commerce to communication. Let's look at them one by one. Starting from the economic ripple effect, which has so much accelerated and cemented different trends and behaviors over the last 24 months. And what we have done over the last year and a couple of months is a big research across 19 markets with consumers, qualitative and quantitative, to understand what's happening and to get some numbers and some trends. What we find fascinating is that behind these 9 universal consumer behavior which emerged, digital is a common thread across all of them. Across each one of them. And let me just pick 3 as an example of behaviors which I think that will continue way after the recession and the downturn is finished. The first one is cocooning, which is about staying in, staying at home, doing things in a different way, benefit from digital entertainment, gaming, streaming TV, downloads music, movies, using digital at home to do things without the need to go out. The second one that I wanted to mention is free fun, which really is everything which is low-cost entertainment via the net, being it on a mobile or a fixed platform. And the third one, which is important, is breaks on buying, where more consumers are really seeking out price comparisons, deals, bulk buying, coupons via the web. It has really accelerated this trend, which was there, of course, before the recession, but it has accelerated to a new level today. I think these numbers provide a bit more textures on the smart shopping behavior I was mentioning. And you can see how the internet is really playing a significant role in enabling these smart shoppers to research products, compare prices, get better deals online, much more than they did before the recession. And If you have a look at this chart, talking about free fund and cocooning, don't read the details because you can see it, but on the left, on the blue bars, you can see behaviors that consumers are doing more after the crisis. Things like chatting, socializing, streaming video, surfing. On the right, on the contrary, in the yellow bars, you see what consumers are doing less, which is going to live events, movies, museums, doing things outside, and normally things that have a price and a ticket connected to this. Now, the big question that we're asking about ourselves, and of course nobody has the answer, is are these trends going to continue? Are they set in stone? Are we going to see them for the next 5-10 years, or were just examples during the last 24 months because of specific events which have happened? Well, we can only listen to consumers, and what they say, 3 out of 4 of them, is that they're there to stay. They're there as a permanent behavior which is going to color their life in the future. The second force which is shaping the future, as I was saying, is access. And it's really transforming digital engagement because of connectivity, which is becoming much more wireless, broadband, which is enabling much richer and faster connections every day, the launch of 4G, et cetera, et cetera, and devices, which have really become multidimensional gateways to content, more than single pieces of hardware. The lines are blurring, all the devices are becoming the same, and they seem to do similar things. The smartphone nowadays looks like a gaming device. The gaming console is looking a lot like a home entertainment console. And the iPad is really merging the capabilities of a laptop, smartphone, e-reader, and another device. So it's really critical that we understand how to develop seamless cross-platform content and messaging strategies. Seamless because we may see the difference between a device and the other, we may have different strategies, but the consumer certainly doesn't. He gets and he hears and he listens to this buzz, he gets a conversation. He doesn't know where it comes from, nor is it relevant where it comes from. It's a conversation that is happening seamlessly across all the devices. We think in terms of platforms, the consumer obviously doesn't. Now, the real news is that the next 1 billion internet users will leapfrog straight to the mobile web experience, bypassing the PC-based experience as we know it, because that's where we come from as a generation. And the majority of these new users will come from emerging, very populous countries like China, like India, like big parts of Africa. The third grounding point, looking at current ongoing trends, is the era of mobility, which is so profoundly changing the game for consumers and marketers. And we are using appropriately, I think, the term mobility and not mobile, because it's not just about the mobile phone. It's a lot more than the mobile phone. It's really about a portable web experience, whatever form the hardware that may manifest itself in. And mobility is much bigger than the mobile phone alone, because while we know the smartphone penetration is expected to reach 40% worldwide over the next 3 years, which is a huge number, and many people believe is underestimated, and that it actually may be much more than 40% over the next 3 years, this is only a very, very small part of what Morgan Stanley has predicted to be 10 billion wireless devices in use by 2013. 2013 is tomorrow. 10 billion devices at a wireless level. And I mean, this really, again, what I said before, it really forces us to think about how to engage with consumers across an entire ecosystem of wireless devices. Smartphones, netbooks, tablets, e-readers, handheld gaming devices, GPS devices, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We look at them as separate platforms, the consumer doesn't. How do we have a message which is totally consistent and it reaches the same people and it generates conversations using so many different platforms? But let's ground ourselves even more in these numbers, and let's look at another couple of statistics that help to understand the magnitude, the scale of the developments. Going back to mobile phone, penetration globally today is at 4 billion subscribers, which is a huge number if you think of the worldwide population. But let's do some comparisons with other devices. This means there is 2.5 times the number of PCs, 3.5 times the number of landline phones, which by the way is beginning now to decline, and 4 times the number of televisions. And if we look at the future, over the next 2 years, these 4 billion people will become 5.5 billion people, which is 77, 80% of the worldwide population. And as we said before, 40% of these 5.5 billion are smartphones. And I think that the most important point on this slide is that the mobile phone will overtake the PC as the most common web access device within the next 3 years. Again, this is a well-known statistic. Is it 3 years or is it 2? Are we going to get there much faster than we expected? And personally, I think yes. And I think this creates a huge challenge for agencies, for marketers, for clients, for the industry, really, in that we still have so much to learn about mobile as a marketing platform, and we don't have time anymore because we are there. It's happening in front of us. PC-based PC-based activities are also migrating to mobile devices. As you can see from these staggering statistics on this chart, a substantial amount of shopping transactions, social networking, search queries, video streaming will occur on mobile devices over the next 2-3 years. And every time we, and I'm sure you've seen other examples of these numbers over the last few hours or yesterday, but every time we see these numbers, they're changing. They're bigger, and everything is happening faster. The final, and perhaps one of the most important, grounding point in terms of today's realities is the social web. And this is a really critical one, because it's a lot more than some of the questions we often hear in our business and in our industry. What should my Facebook strategy be? What should my Twitter strategy be? We really need to reframe this perspective entirely, because social is now the identity system, the behavioral overlay of the entire web, influencing everything from search to commerce to communication, enforcing a profound change in the rules of consumer engagement. And let me give you a couple of examples. If we look first at the dawn of social search, we can see what Google and Bing are doing, and I don't know, 2 or 3 examples. Google's real-time search includes real-time social media feeds from a variety of sources and lists them within its organic search results. Google's social search provides a more focused search result based on users' social graph. Bing tweets, like Google Real-Time, is harnessing live feeds from Twitter into their search results. Now, these are just examples, and some of these products have been more successful or will be more successful than others. What I think is really important is that the direction towards an increasingly personalized web is very clear and is there to stay, towards a much more personalized web. The second area that brings this evolving role of social to life is the socialization of commerce, which is influencing many new business models. Let me just focus on the second example that we have on this chart, which is how the socialization of commerce can be leveraged as a powerful marketing approach. And this is an example from Dell and Intel last year in Singapore, where they partner, these two companies, both client of ours, to leverage what they call the power of the swarm, which essentially was consumers being encouraged to reach out to their entire social graph and invite them to join in on a great deal. And the larger the group, the lower the purchase price of the computers. And the numbers kept becoming higher and higher and higher, way beyond the expectations of the plan at the beginning, so much so that they're now thinking of rolling this out certainly across Asia Pacific and possibly across the world. So the consumer really taking an important role within their social system and using their communities to drive down the price of something that they would like to buy. So if social is rewriting the rules of consumer engagements, I think there are three impactful, meaningful, and actionable trends that we can learn and take and use. I think the first one is that sharing is the new giving. And this has a lot of implication in terms of the type of content and brand experiences that we create, because unless these are valuable, entertaining, relevant, they will be absolutely meaningless. The second rule is that participation is the new consumption, and this is about recognizing that consumers have become active participants and contributors. They're not passive, they're participating and they're building content themselves. The third one is that consumer reviews are the new advertising, and this is possibly the most important one. And I think that the notion is that the conversation is happening with us or without us. It's just happening. The conversation is moving on. And very scarily, 25% of search results today for the world's top 20 brands are linked to content created by consumers. So 25% of search results for the world's top 20 brands are linked to content created by consumers. This is a monstrous change. Yeah, they don't make it to the top. They're not in the first page. They're not in the top five or the top 10, but they're getting there. So consumer-generated content getting in the top of search results. And I think that the conclusion of these three thoughts, sharing the new giving, participation is the new consumption, and consumer reviews are the new advertising, is that we really need to be thinking much more holistically and strategically about engagement strategies that link together paid, owned, and earned assets in the same way that the consumer sees them. So if we have talked about today, what are the most significant and actionable global digital trends over the next 2-3 years? And we think there are four which are shaping the future of engagement. And we call them fluid, focused, fast, and forecastable. And let me start with fluid and a couple of examples. And by fluid, we mean what speaks to the borderless exchange of data between consumers, between platforms, and between a platform and a consumer. As I said, let me show you two or three examples. Let me put all of them on the charts so it's easier and quicker. If we talk about fluid experience, well, look at Layer augmented reality browser, where through a camera or a cell phone, you can see the surrounding and the layer of extra information within and beyond the landscape you're watching. And if you think of the implication this could have in last minute decisions, in creating new opportunities for consumptions, in informing us about new products, in getting the consumer closer to places that he may not have been looking for in the last minute. If you look at fluid content, a good example is what Ford is doing with the Sync, which is a factory-installed in-car communication and entertainment systems, which puts together the mobile phone, other digital media players, and allows to use the commands on the steering wheel or the volume controls to play all of this together, giving access to hopefully not to drivers, but to the people sitting next to the driver, giving them access to their Twitter account, browsing maps, listening to internet radio, check the movie times, have the car systems helping them to control and navigate. The third one could be, an example could be Microsoft Project Natal, where for the Xbox 360, which really enables users to control and interact with Xbox without the need to touch the game controller, where the system can read and react to gestures, spoken commands, and read objects and images as presented to them. And the fourth one is one that we all know very, very well in the area of fluid transactions. Take mobile in Japan, for example, where consumers can now pay at McDonald's just by swiping their cell phones or using them for a train fare, and really making the use of money, of cash, absolutely redundant in today's economy. Or TwitPay could be another example in fluid transactions, where there's a Twitter-based service allows users to send money between people, between Twitters, without having to go through a separate channel like a bank, which traditionally charges money and takes time at every step. The next future trend is focused, and this is really all about pinpoint accuracy in terms of targeting, in terms of location, and in terms of messaging. And again, I can give you a couple of examples. Focused targeting, which you can see on the top left, is all about the opportunity to deploy these rich insights provided by social media and mobile to further understand and work with a target consumer base. It's not just the who, where, when, and what, but it's also behavior location, mood, social interactions, so we can have a much better one-on-one conversation with these identified consumers. Foursquare doesn't need any introduction. How many people in the audience use Foursquare? Bit less here, but 20-25%. It looks from the number. I think you all know what it is, and is becoming and is developing into a fantastic community enablers, where friends can listen and act based on your suggestions, tips, and reach you or others into places which have been recommended, going way beyond the knowledge of the places themselves. It doesn't matter if it's the restaurant, the bar, the museum, the club. They normally don't even know this is happening, and probably the next stage is how to exploit that commercially, because effectively communities are driving traffic to different places, and that traffic has a value. And in terms of focused messaging, I think that Amazon recommendation engine is a very good example of what smart messaging is, and doesn't need any introduction. The next trend is called fast, and as it says, is everything not happening just faster than before, but I think the concept is things happening in real time. And again, I've got three examples on fast engagement, fast insights, and fast analysis, where for fast engagement, take McDonald's as an example, when they used the QR codes in Japan to deliver product and promotional information in real time by having the code on the Big Mac packaging, so that they could distribute through the QR code immediate real-time nutritional information that could be accessed immediately and could be updated instantly every time there was a change in the recipe, without the need of reprinting and redoing and redistributing all the packaging. So there was a real value for the company, and there was a real value for the consumer. Fast insight and fast analysis, I think you can look at them together. It's on one side is how to harness all those insights coming from relevant social media and trend forums and sites, and how to deploy them in real time so they can help us to take better decisions. And think, for example, of ad exchanges on the trading side, or think of dashboards, where we are all investing so much money in making sure that this series of massive information become available to us, to our clients, so that decisions can be taken with real-time data and not just looking at insights on data that is based on 6, 12, 18 months before, and that is in most cases not relevant anymore. The next big trend, and probably the most important, is forecastable. And it's all about having a much more robust measurement framework, ultimately, to be able to identify what are the leading indicators of what business success looks like. Of course, that is a holy grail, is what we all look forward to, have all the information that can predetermine how to reach success within the next marketing program. And don't look at this in too much detail, because there is too much information inside, and this is just a framework to help taking decisions which are much more data-driven. And if we look at the way that Intel's measurement system and principles are, there are two things which I think are very important that they have adopted, and I have to say that we as an agency have learned so much from them. The first principle that they have is measuring what really matters. What activities do we really value along the purchase funnel or whatever the purchase path looks like? And the second one, what is the actionable data that we have relative to that question? Because anything else really should not be a priority, because too often we suffer from data paralysis, too much information, too much contrasting information, which is not really helping us to take real-time, quick, relevant decision. And the second principle which they apply, which I think is fascinating, is how you then connect all the dots between the engagement touch points, including both online and offline, using this data. And here you start to have a bigger picture and to identify the leading indicators of what is happening with the business. Now, with that, if I manage to click, with that picture and that framework in mind, I think that if we agree on all of that, there are a few lessons that can be taken for here, and we've tried to codify it into 8 points that we think are important for us as an agency, we think they're important for our clients, and we think they're important for the industry. So let me go through these 8 points very quickly, and then perhaps we can discuss them in the Q&A later. What are the strategic implications of what is happening today and the trends which are happening and shaping the industry over the next 24, 36 months? The first one, as we see it, is to have a transition mindset. Organizations need to transition their mindset to think about digital as an enabler to achieve broader business objectives, not just as a media channel, because it's not just a media channel. The second one is have a vision. We think that marketeers should have a vision that asks, what are we trying to solve for? And how can digital help? How can it provide the solution to this marketing opportunity? The third one that we mentioned before is apply a consumer lens, because we need to recognize that this new ecosystem is seamless, is borderless, and it crosses all platforms as seen by the consumers, not as seen by us, the marketeers. So all strategies and initiatives and messaging need to be in sync, from marketing to communication to retail to recruiting. We have to eliminate silos. It's the only way to achieve holistic strategies and executions. Organizations really must eliminate, or at very least bridge, the silos which are still so much existing in our business. The fifth one is to become a living brand, and the idea here is that brands have to become much more dynamic and human, and actively listen, learn, participate, share, engage with the key constituents that they playing with. Number six is to champion a beta mindset. We need to test, we need to learn, we need to facilitate innovation and experimentation and sharing of this best practice in order to stay ahead of these changes in the digital economy. The seventh one for us is learn and share, mandating continuous digital learnings and sharing of best practice to help organizations to be more nimble, more agile in this extremely fast-paced world. And the eighth and last is to define strategic metrics. What really defines and measures the core business objectives? How do we move away from fluffy, I call them, marketing KPIs, and move to proper, measurable business KPIs? It doesn't matter if it is sales, loyalty, productivity, trial, but really measurable and identifiable KPIs. And how can we as an industry be measured on these successes so that our whole remuneration is based on delivering of a KPI which affects the sales or the success of the brands that our clients are marketing? And I think that is possibly the most important one, how to create a new currency and a new measurement across the whole ecosystem to measure not just the outputs in separate ways, which is what we've been doing for the last 20 years, even before the digital era, but how can we measure conversations, including everything which goes from paid to owned to earned, and have a real value, and using that for trading in in media and understanding what final effect it will have on the sales of the product. Okay, and I think we've discussed a lot of exciting opportunities and challenges, many challenges for the future, and I thought it was only fitting to end on this famous quote from Darwin, which always reminds us that responsiveness to change is the only trait that guarantees survival. If we don't change, we die, and that's why we called it the inflection point, and we demanded this change in the industry, and that's why we've taken this presentation to all our staff globally, across 100-plus offices at every level of the company, because we want to make sure that we speak the same language and we have a deep understanding of what is happening in the marketplace to share in the same way across geography with our clients. Thank you very much, and I think that we now have a series of questions or Q&A. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bernardo. Before we move on into some questions, I've been asked to just remind everyone that it is possible to take questions from the audience. Those of you who might have a mobile email device in your pocket, if you have questions that you'd like to pose, if you could email those to moderator@domexico.com, the AV team will make sure that those come to the front, and hopefully we'll be able to have some time for that. I know the program is running just a little bit late, so I think we're probably going to aim for about 10 minutes of Q&A, and hopefully at least delve into a few more of the points that Bernardo brought up. Particularly appreciated the number of examples that you showed in terms of the ways in which different clients are using digital. And I think the first question I'd like to start with is just the focus on earned and, I suppose, to a certain extent, owned media assets is certainly taking an increasingly large component of marketing budgets and even mindshare of people involved in this business. How would you say that it affects, or where, for that matter, does that leave paid media? And I think at the end of the day, maybe the simple question is, what if you were sitting in front of a large brand media owner, paid media owner, what would your advice be to make sure that they still stay relevant and really core to global brand digital strategies?
Well, a way to look at it is that a beautiful car with a great engine and a fantastic design doesn't actually move and perform its objective in life if it doesn't have any petrol. I think that paid for media is a petrol, is what generates the movement, is what links the consumer to owned media, is what drives this journey, this conversation with the brand. And without paid for media, however good the owned media is, it's difficult to find it, it's difficult to connect it, it's difficult to direct it to the right people. So I think the connection between paid for and owned generates the earned, generates the conversations, generate this long-lasting benefit for the brands, but then it just doesn't start without the paid for. So we tend to look at it as one integrated movement. What we lack is what I was saying before. We lack a measurement. We lack a new currency. We lack an index to measure these conversations, and not just paid for and everything else in a separate way.
Right. Although the fracture in the business model is that largely the paid-for media model has been paid for by brand advertising, and brand advertising is still a small fracture of actual spend in digital. Where would you see that heading directionally? And you know, one would hope to think that whereas two-thirds of overall marketing budgets are now devoted to brand and roughly a third go to direct response, in digital currently it's more like a quarter going to brand and three-quarters going to direct response. Where's the inflection point where brands start to really see digital as a broader brand platform?
I think it depends which side you look at it from, because if you look at it from the output, you're absolutely right. There isn't enough money going into so-called digital opportunities for brand advertising. But if you look at the input into the consumer, a lot of the branding which is taking place is happening in a digital environment. It just happens that it's not paid for.
Right.
Fair enough. It is happening, but it's not linked to the paid for. You can guess that with so many hours spent there, the two things will become more and more together. And I think that more and more we don't differentiate on brand advertising between digital and non-digital media. It's just whatever is right for that specific action.
So it's obviously an increasingly complex process. So where does that leave agencies? Do they come increasingly specialist or increasingly more simply aggregators and aggregators and integrators, if you will?
Well, the first answer I would have given, how does it leave agencies? I would say poorer, unfortunately, because everything takes time, and it's more people that have to be dedicated to a lot more things that we have to do than we had in the past. But instead of looking at it as a negative, we need to do more work to achieve the same results. Let's look at it as a positive. And the moment that we can really have better currencies to measure output and to measure what value we are delivering to the brands, that is much easier to have a proper remuneration, which is linked to the value of what we deliver, not to the cost of the performance. And if it is linked to value, it's not a percentage, it's not a fee, it's a proportion of the value that is created that normally way pays for the hours that we have to put in.
Well, and on the subject of remuneration, just a final question, because I'm being memoed here that we're just about to run out of time. But on the subject of remuneration, a lot of your presentation focused on fluid, focused, fast, forecastable. Again, I'll use the word again, but complexity seems to be central and core to virtually every one of those. At the end of the day, it requires not just a complex strategy, but complex resources to deliver, and increasingly greater technology resources and people. There's a kind of a mantra right now in the media world that every editor, you should have a technologist. How many of your staff are going to be technologists? And I guess at the end of the day, how does that affect how much it costs? And finally, whether clients are ready for that cost to come through?
Well, it's another very good question. We all have to invest a lot more in the agencies than we have in the past, and technology and talent are becoming the two most important investments. I think that we're making the right investments, and we have many technology or digitally based clients like Intel, Apple, Sony, Vodafone. So I think that we've done relatively good. Well, otherwise these clients wouldn't have followed us. But are we investing enough? What is enough? Is this enough, or do we need to do a bit more? No, I think that we always have to do a lot more, and we need media owners, provider of contents, clients, everybody in the industry to play this game. We've recently done a big global deal with Google, which really is based on that. How do we tap into their technological resources, and how do we benefit from their investments for the benefit of our clients? How can you use what they've already done once instead of us having to do it again? Mm-hmm. And it goes without saying that their technological capabilities are far superior to the one that any agency can have in the world. So I think we need new ways of benefiting from the technology which exists, but the investments are unlimited, and there is a lot more than we all need to do in that area.
Very good. Well, I think we're going to have to close there, unfortunately, because, like I say, we're needing to move on to the next panel. But I would just appreciate if you could show your appreciation for our speaker once again before we move on to the next panel.
Thank you very much.